real quick because you list your documents that you have in this envelope, which will be your affidavit, the remittance, and your notary stuff. Because basically, what you're doing by having it notarized with your list of documents is there you have a third party that's sworn to uphold an oath that can validate. Yeah, these are the documents that were in there. I stamped it. You got your registered mail number, which certifies it in the postal system. That if you ever need to reference that, you can track that number. They can say it was delivered and received by this person. And nowadays, you can even get it with an electronic confirmation for like $1.15 more or something, where you don't, it'll electronically tell you who signed for it. You can look it up online.
Okay.
And that protects yourself, because then if you have anything that goes wrong, this is how I heard a saying. You do everything as if you're preparing yourself for court. So if you follow these certain steps, you're preparing yourself for court in the event that there is whatever malfunction on their part. You prepared yourself for court, and you go and you win.
Right, right. Well, any exchange of documentation between one party to another actually is court. I mean, that's private court, and that's actually what the magistrate actually looks at when you take it to public court. The only time that we actually go to public court is when the parties cannot agree amongst each other. But we're in court every day. Anytime that you get a bill or whatever in the mail, or you get someone sends you something that they claim you owe and you keep it, that's acceptance. What is acceptance is a form of agreement. So whatever you get in the mail for entertainment purposes or educational purposes, you always return it to the sender. You never keep it. Acceptance is a form of agreement. It's compliant. You're consenting.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Another thing, we know you do the teachings with the traffic tickets and whatnot. Now, we just recently got two traffic violations in the same day and whatnot, me and her both. Okay, and you said, okay, we have to comply. We have to respond to them within 10 days. And I noticed that it says on the ticket, come in before or on the such day, okay? And you say
well,
you're supposed to have.
Well, start right there, brother. The reason that they want you to respond within 10 days is because when you go down there on 10 days, you're already actually going to be pretty much guilty. Then you're going to have to argue the facts. I never like to argue the facts. Whenever you get a moving violation, a citation, or whatever, you want to try your best to actually resolve it within 72 hours. A ticket, again, is a transaction of a security interest. Any transaction of a security interest, you have 72 hours to resolve. If you're trying to resolve that within a 72-hour time frame, the way to properly do that is to go down to wherever they say that you can actually pay this, go to the clerk, take two witnesses with you, tell the clerk that you're here to settle this citation. 99% of the time, the clerk is going to say, well, it's not into the system yet. We can't do that. So you need to get a statement from the clerk stating that they said that you cannot settle it. Then you get a statement from both of your witnesses on an affidavit. And then you submit that to the court. When you go to the court, public court, that is, you're going to have this on the record that you attempted to resolve this and they didn't want to resolve it. So, hey,
okay.
There's no subject matter jurisdiction. I mean, subject matter is jurisdiction, and it should be dismissed on that because they don't have any jurisdiction over you. You actually already moved to resolve this, and it's not your fault that they couldn't resolve it. The 10-day thing is just a way of trying to make sure that you get that they have you in the system so that they could charge you.
Exactly. Okay. I was just making sure that, I got all the procedures. Now, with this, if we do not have two witnesses, would one be beneficial? Would it be substantial? Would it hold up?
What say is the scriptures? Again, I tell you, if you keep the scriptures in mind, you can't go wrong. The scripture says, if you cannot agree with your brother, take two witnesses with you. Does not the scripture say that?
Exactly.
Yeah. All of this is built on scripture, brother. If you keep that in mind, you're going to find out that all of this is built on scriptures, their whole court system. But they just do it deceptively, and they've altered things around. Take two witnesses with you, brother.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I think at one point they had the lawyer study the Bible as part of a law degree.
Right.
Man. Okay. I appreciate you, brothers, man. Like I said, once again, y'all guys have been so much help. I really do appreciate it.
Thank you, brother. And by the way, brother, your wife done homework, right?
Yes.
Yeah, keep in mind what I said about the rules of commerce. A birth certificate is a form of registration. Right now, they have no authority whatsoever over your child. That's your child, unless you went and got a birth certificate. That means CPS, no one could actually come in and do anything to your child because you haven't registered a child. That's your child. They have no authority. No one has any authority over your child at this point.
Mm-hmm.
But if you go and get a birth certificate, say, for instance, if you need, like, immunization shots, they're going to tell you that, well, to get those, you need a birth certificate. And once you get the birth certificate, your child is registered over to the state, and then CPS can move in on your child. Now, I'm not suggesting that you don't get one. I just thought I'd put that information out there.
Gotcha. That's very useful. I appreciate that.
Oh.
I will definitely make a large notice of that. So we keep that in mind.
All right, brother.
What about the...
Anyone else have a question? Massachusetts? Michigan?
Large. Brother Tazadok, shalom.
Shalom, brother.
Shalom. I have a quick question. My wife and I are about to send out a bunch of eighth of these. What we were wondering is the carbon copies that go to the IRS, could we put all of those in one envelope?
I believe someone asked us that last week. I actually never tried it that way. I always sent the individual, you know, envelope. I've actually never tried it that way. I always sent the individual envelope for each business or whatever.
Yeah.
And then that went to the IRS. Maybe you could do it that way. I would suppose you would.
I mean.
But I never tried it that way, so I can't really speak from experience on that.
I see.
Keep them separate. Keep them separate. Yeah, keep them separate for your. See, you got to, you know, you got to. It's a. Think of it as, a, you know, each one is an equation. You wouldn't want to mix two different math problems in a long division, you know, when you're writing all that stuff down. So, basically, what I'm saying is you should have a folder. I mean, I'm not going to tell you how to be organized, but the way I do mine is I have a folder, okay? And I might write, let's say, like they were talking about the phone company on it. I might write phone company on that folder.
Okay.
Now, what I do is I have my remittance, I have my letter, you know, my affidavit, and I have my my notary, you know. And I can put all that in a folder. I can mark the date on there that I'm doing this one. And I can make copies. I can send it to the different people. But here's what's important. You heard me say registered mail a couple different times today.
Yes.
When you send that out, registered mail, that is an identifying form of mailing. So when you send that registered to the CFO, you're going to have one registered mail sticker. I can read one off. It starts with the RA, and it's got 3, 6, 9 numbers, and it says U.S. at the end. It's the red sticker with the barcode. I'm sitting here looking at 5 or 6 of them. And then you get a little slip that goes with it, that's blank, and you fill out registration fee. I mean, you only have a handling charge at it, but what you're going to fill out is the actual part that says customer must declare full value. You want to put $20 there. It's got two boxes next to it that says with postal insurance, without postal insurance. You want to check without postal insurance so that it's not insured, so they cannot replace it if it's lost or whatever they claim. Then it's got the regular from and to, you know, from you and to who you're sending. Now, then they put all that information in the system, okay, and it's registered.
Talk fast, man.
So when you send, then that way you send the registered mail to the CFO and one to Ogden, and you mark down, keep a record of that receipt, or you make copies, whatever works best for you, and you be sure to include those registered mail numbers. Because now, if anything happens, you can pull out your phone bill folder, go to court, and you got all your documents that's also signed by a notary on your as a third-party witness to what you've done. Now, sending it registered mail makes it, like I said, with the from the article on the Constitution, it makes it able to go to a trial by jury. So that's to your benefit if you need to take it that route. So I would not include, you know, 5 or 10 different things in one registered mail, because each registered mail should be for that one specific purpose. So that when they pull that number, it's just for that one thing, nothing else. No confusion. Now, registered mails is a little bit pricey. I just sent some things off, and it was I sent two items registered with the electronic, you know, return receipt, or not, you know, electronic signature. So you can just punch in your little code and go online and see who signed for it. You don't get the actual regular normal green slip. And it was like about $30 for two mailings. But that protects you.
Mm-mm.
Okay? So I would keep them separate and pay the extra money. I'm a fan of you get what you pay for.
Yes. All right. So for the phone bill, did you ask for, like, the estimate for the year and just pay for the year, or you do that every month?
Well, what I would do, I mean, you can word it as and let them decide what's best for them. Because what you want to also do is let them know that they have the authority to, however it's most easy for them to process it. So I actually give them the option to either do a monthly, you know, amount of what almost like double my phone bill, or to, you know, let's say take a one-time $25,000 dischargement.
Mm-hmm.
Because then what happens is once you send that off to the IRS is going to look at that and say, $25,000? You know, it's not a $100 phone bill. Who wants to really argue and go through all this paperwork and call phone calls for over $100?
Yeah.
You know, but you put $25,000 on there, IRS is going to be like, we want our money.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean? Don't be afraid to use large numbers. I mean, at the end of the day, it's not coming out of your pocket. It's coming out of the treasury.
Right.
But you want to make it worthwhile, so that if there is anything going down, you know, it's going to be worthwhile for them to go follow up on this for you, because $25,000 to phone company ABC will get a lot more attention than, you know, $100 mishap.
You know what? I'd like to thank you, brothers, for what you're doing. I mean, stepping out, giving away this information is very valuable. I mean, you couldn't put a price on what you guys are doing. I'm going to continue to keep you, Brother Tazi Dog, Ryan, Marcus, all of you here in my prayers, you know, and I thank you. My wife thanks you. We thank you from the bottom of our heart. Thank you very much. I'll let you move on to the next caller.
Hey, thank you, brother. You're welcome.
Yes, thank you.
Southern California, you have any questions?
Yeah, I got a question.
How's it going, brother?
I'm doing good. Shalom to you, brother.
Shalom.
My question was about, I did my cover letter today, and I'm getting ready to put out my April V's, but I was wondering, is it possible to do my car insurance since it doesn't come with a coupon?
If you can keep it, I've actually I haven't done a car insurance. If you could keep it, then yeah.
And I was also wondering. Well, no, you asked my other question as far as like the phone block. I'm glad that brother asked that question. My next one was, is it possible to receive any funds back some of these APBs, because usually when I do mine, I give them a little more than what they're asking for.
Well, I actually, yeah, I always give them a little more. I've actually heard of someone trying to do that, but they didn't actually get anything back. But I don't know. I don't know if I would actually try that, because as I actually recited earlier, they said that they would actually discharge our debt. So discharge it. They didn't say that they would actually provide us any kind of funds or money or anything of that nature. Now, what you're talking about actually goes into the secured party creditor and, you know, tapping into your account when you become executor of your estate. So me personally, I wouldn't use the A for V to try and get money back. But, again, that's just me.
Yeah. I mean, if you can pay just about anything you can get a bill for, I mean, pretty much any money you make should be your private stash, so to speak. You know, it should be your private little money. You go out there and paint your neighbor's, you know, house for $1,000, do a great job, they give you $1,000. That should be your little Chuck E. Cheese money, so to speak, in America. You know, you really shouldn't have to owe that to anything or use that to pay.
Right. That's for the private. That's what I was talking about earlier. That's for the private, not for the public, not to pay public debt.
So pretty much anything that's under the corporation, you know, you can discharge, which is almost everything that you're looking at. You can't make a purchase with it. Like you can't go to, like you say, you can't go to McDonald's and say, hey, I want to discharge my number 7. You know, that's not going to work. Like the utility companies, you got your, you know, almost everything you think of largely is owned by government. Like,
right, so basically any bills or debts basically is what we can discharge.
Right. So, I mean, how do you honestly say that's not some form of let's say, greed? You know, because we got to be responsible with this. Because everything we do, it's just like the gun laws. Like, if you have your concealed carry license, you know, which, you know, it's a license. But for those that got concealed carry, when you talk to them, they'll tell you that everything you do represents the entire whole community. And they're looking for every little reason to try and say, oh, concealed carry, they're bad, they're terrible, we got to do this to get rid of them. So we got to be responsible with this. Because they're looking for all kind of reasons to have loopholes to pull this or to cover it up or to taint the image of who we really are. So, you know, let's just use it for what it's designed to do, and we can all live like that.
Trouble or anything of that nature.
Yeah, I mean, if your phone bill is $100, send them $10,000. You ain't got to worry about your phone bill for I don't know how long that is. You got new phones every time they come out because you've already put the credit into the system because you're the creditor. You know? We just got to separate ourselves from the debtor mentality and start thinking like the creditor.
Right, right.
Yeah, I always enter as the secured party creditor and trustee and beneficiary of my trademark, Starman.
Yeah. So this credit all your accounts. Make a couple dollars here and there. Buy your number 7 cash. But everything else pretty much paid for, you know?
Let's go to Northern Virginia. You have any questions, Northern Virginia? Northern Virginia, you have any questions? What about West Maryland? Any questions?
Yeah, I have a question.
Rachel, how's it going, brother?
I'm doing pretty good.
when it comes to the discharge and the debts and you know on the A for V, when you get a bill in the mail and it tells you to mail the payments to a certain address or mail the no payments to a certain address, when you accept this value, would you send it to the mail payments to address and ask for the CFO?
I have a series of videos on accepting for value on YouTube. Did you see those, brother?
Yeah, I see those. I have took notes and everything down on everything. I'm just saying the actual.
You're gonna send it to that address, but you're gonna make the attention to the CFO, so they can get in the right hands. You don't want them to say, well, this person doesn't work here. You want to send it to the chief financial officer so it gets in the right hands.
But make sure it's the one that say mail payments to.
I mean, if you have any doubt, I'll tell you what you do. Okay? You know, or whatever day you have free to yourself, and you make that call to customer service, and you ask them for the location of the Department of Finance or the chief financial officer. They're going to put you on hold. They're going to transfer you a couple times. But if it's any address different than what's on there, they're going to give it to you. They may not want to give you the exact name because they're not going to really know why you're calling. But, I mean, if you have any doubts, just give them a call. Ask them for the address. Because I did have one situation where the department itself was in a building that they have in another part of the country. Department of Finance itself.
That's what it's looking like this one is.
But it'll forward, if you send it to their address to the chief financial officer or director of finance, it'll forward, of course, if you send it registered mail, you have you're protecting yourself, but it'll forward to them because anything else would be interference with the mail or whatever, you know, Taz would be more familiar with the direct terminology, but it'll be some sort of interference with the process of the mail. If they did not ensure that it reached the destination that you addressed it to.
Right. Well, that's their responsibility.
Okay, so you said as long as I get it certified and everything, it should make its way.
Do not go there and ask for certified mail. It registered mail. It's a red sticker, and they give you a little blank carbon copy form. They're going to run it through the computer. You declare the value for $20. You don't have to pay $20. I mean, not for the value, but you just declare the value of the mailings for $20. And, you know, it might be like $14 or $15 to mail it, but do not tell the post office certified mail. That's a totally different mail.
Okay. See, that's the only thing. Like, I was good with everything else. I only had the point of the actual mailing it, I had, like, put private and confidential all over the mail and attention to the CFO. I just wanted to make sure when I actually got in the post office, that I go with registered mail or certified.
Yeah, they're gonna have fun with you at the post. It's a very special mailing to them. They really take pride and they put on all the ends of the thing. They stamp it. They do all the stuff on the computer. They run the stuff through the little printer and they it's your receipt's about 3 feet long. You know, it's a great process. People behind you are like, what is he doing? Okay, but you want to make sure it's the red sticker. And they're going to give you this little form to fill out. You'll get a copy, and they keep a copy, and everything's input into the system, and it's all linked with that registered mail number that has a.
Okay. Makes sense. That's about the only question I had today. I'd like to thank all y'all for all y'all input and help on this situation, because I was really looking for. Some answers on that subject.
Hey, thank you, brother. What about South Texas? You have any questions?
Hi, I do.
Hey, how you doing, sister?
I'm doing well. Thank you. Appreciate all that you have to all you all sharing this knowledge. I've just been researching your videos and reading up on the information of the A4B, and I got on the call kind of late, so I apologize if I'm repeating myself from other callers. But I was listening to the brother before about addressing the envelope correctly. For instance, I'm following the A4V process where you return it for accepted for value using the bond number and the routing number. But when I address the, let's say, electric bill, I called the utility department and asked for the address to the Department of Finance. They told me to go on ahead and just send it to the P.O. box that's on the bill. Is that going to be sufficient?
Well, yeah, I mean, you send it there and address the envelope to the CFO. It's their responsibility to get it into the hands of the CFO.
Okay. Okay, great. I just wanted to make sure that I didn't know if P.O. box were different or not. Another question, as far as, like, debt that is apparently, like, that is one person owes, let's say it's no longer with the creditor and it's now sent off to a collection agency, how does one proceed to get that, get that taken care of, but not obviously, because I was listening on some past calls that you have recorded that we have no business handling with them because they're just a third party.
Right.
Wait.
It's been, yeah.
With collection, generally, if it's actually sent to collections, you got to check and see if they're even affiliated with the creditor. What collection agencies has a tendency to do is that and they actually buy it like a stock for, like, you know, a very inexpensive amount. And what they do, then they actually decide to come after you. And sometimes you got to check and see if these lawyers are even bonded to practice law in your state, because most of them are not. And if they're not, then it's like they're guilty of mail fraud. And if, you know, sometimes the collection agency actually comes after you and the debt has already been settled and closed. So you actually got to check your credit report to see if the debt has already been settled and closed.
Mm-hmm.
If the debt has been settled and closed, then the collection agency is actually, you know, like in violation of the Fair Debt Collection Practice Act, 15 U.S.C. 1692, Section 809. And if they're in violation of that, you could actually, you know, the federal offense for that is $1,000. I don't know what the, each state has its own way of actually dealing with that. So you have to look at the statutory for that in your particular state. But, yeah, I checked and see if they even or even authorized to be contacting you. But what you need to do is to send them a debt validation letter to even make sure that that's a valid debt. Ask them questions like, you know, where's my contract with you? Prove that I have a contract with you. What is the money that you say that I owe for? Explain and show me how you calculate it, what you say I owe. Provide me with copies of papers, you know, with your signature. And most collection agencies can't produce that because they weren't the original creditor in the first place. And if they can't produce that, then they shouldn't actually even be dealing with you. And tell them to provide, like, verification and copies of any kind of judgment if there's a said judgment against you. And also tell them to identify the original creditor and show you that they have a license to collect in your state. If not, then they're in violation. And if it's an attorney, and usually collection agencies or attorneys, make them swear under penalty of perjury and tell them to respond to you on an affidavit and tell them to stop contacting you by phone if they're contacting you by phone and request that they contact you by mail so you could actually establish a record, because that's when court actually begins.
And another real quick, with these mailings and everything, and even outside of the mailings, getting the practice of knowing what you're saying. You know, if you read Artist Deduction or anything like that, I mean, you could play around with these people. You have fun with it. But, like, you call up customer service, you know, somewhere. They ask you to verify your address. You got to remember that these calls are recorded. And when they ask you a question about, like, verify your address, and you say, I'm at 555 North 5th Street, such and such and such, zip code 19999, then you just verify that you have an address. You know, I laugh at them and be like, well, you know, we don't really have addresses, but the location you can supply mail to me at is such and such. And then, you know, get in the habit of saying that, because the more you repeat it on a normal day-to-day basis, the more you got it permanently etched in your brain, and you just start to spit it off. Because, like Brother Ty said, you live in court on a daily basis. So every little question is a verbal contract. And be sure you're putting that mailing together and you have your return address. I wonder how many of y'all have y'all zip codes in brackets. Or something that says non-domestic U.S. on your address. To show that when it runs through the Postal Service, that's not an address. That's how you separate that. But go ahead, please continue.
Oh, no, even with what you just mentioned about the terms we're supposed to be using, I had someone who called me earlier, and with a little bit of practicing and also just over here, you know, listening to the videos and the recorded calls, I just decided to kind of, you know, play their game. And, again, I'm just kind of getting my feet wet. And I asked, you know, the agency wanted to verify who I was. And I just told them, you know, the name that I was given at birth. They wanted to verify my address, and I told them, well, the place that was given to me by the United States Post Office is such and such. And I asked her what was the reason of the call, and she wanted to talk about the business matter, and I immediately asked her, do we have a contract? And then she basically said, I'll send you a letter via mail, and she hung up.
So there you go.
So I was kind of like, I was waiting, you know, for it to go into further detail, but I'm glad it happened today because it's fresh on my mind. So with this being said, you know, because I went through a bad situation years ago where I have a lot of, as we would say, you know, debt that I owe to these credit card companies. But it's getting to the point where there's just so many calls and so forth and letters. So now I know that some of them, well, majority of them are not even with the original company anymore, and now they're with these agencies. So with a person like myself, when they're with these agencies, we no longer need to do business. It is what it is. Like, how do we?
No, well, that's easy. What you need to be doing is actually collect the money from them. Like, if they're in violation of the Fair Debt Act practice, I mean, it's $1,000 per violation. That's on the federal side. So, for instance, if you instruct these people not to call you anymore by phone and you log these calls, each time that they call, they are after is $1,000 for each offense. If they write you and they're actually not the original creditor, and they have no affiliation with the original creditor, each offense is $1,000. So if they contact you five times, or if they actually pull your credit report and actually just from looking at your credit report without authorization, there's a fine for that as well. So, I mean, you could get a copy of the Fair Debt Act online for free. So I actually look into that, and I look into the one for my state in New Jersey. What you need to do is print out your three major credit reports and see if these people actually been looking at your credit. And also see if those debts have actually been set off or sold to these people. And if so, you don't have a contract with these people. So they don't have a right to actually be contacting you unless you agree to contract with them. Now, the tricks that these people use, for instance, they'll say, well, we see that you owe such and such ABC Electric Company $250. We're actually willing to let you make monthly payments of $15. They usually try and give you a ridiculous amount to try and ensure that you'll actually pay it. So when you agree to that, then you just actually consented or constructed to a contract with them. So when they say that to you, you got to be like, well, no, I have no clue what you're talking about. I don't, you know, provide proof, produce the original contract bearing my signature that I actually owe this. And you give them 10 days to do this. If they can't do that, then they're in agreement with you that you don't know any owe anything. Basically, how you deal with that?
Yeah, you don't have a contract with them unless you accept it.
Okay.
And you could also go back to the original. I mean, if they're contacting you, like Brother Ty said, find out if they're affiliated with the actual original company that you had the contract with. If they are, then that means they're working for them, kind of like a in-house department just outsourced. But then your debt is still might be live and with that company, you know, which in that case you can say, I don't want to, you have the option to say, I don't want to deal with you. I'm going to contact company directly. And then you just do the same process with that company by accepting it for value, et cetera.
Okay, got that. Just to recap here, the one with, because I kind of heard other individuals saying that they were sending affidavits and other copies along with their accepted for value and return for value. I mean, I was going over your video, and I have, like, pages, detailed notes on what I do, step one, step two, step three, but I didn't, I guess maybe I missed these other forms that I need to send in. And then am I supposed to also send a copy again to the IRS?
Hold on real quick. Also, did you mention the bond and rally number in the beginning?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah, see, I love Brother Ty is sharing now with the endorsement method, because it's so simple. It's just like a check.
Right. And
what happens is, I mentioned this before, you want to, I don't know if you've already done certain filings to basically depict who you really are, put it on public record, et cetera. But if you don't have, for entertainment purposes, if you don't have ownership of an account, you don't use that account, right? Like, you wouldn't use your neighbor's checkbook you probably wouldn't use it anyway, but what I'm saying is you wouldn't use it definitely if they didn't say it was okay, right?
Right.
Okay, so you kind of don't really want to be using routing numbers and account numbers unless you own that account for entertainment purposes.
Okay.
Okay.
So basically it's just kind of now even more simple. I just endorse the coupon on the back and get my letter, as you guys mentioned, not certified, but the one with the red stamp on there.
Yeah.
And send it to the CFO, and that's it?
CFO, IRS is your backup. Keep a copy for yourself. Now, Now the gentleman was mentioned about, how do I get close to getting cash out of this or something. That's when you're talking bank routing numbers and account numbers, but you got to have ownership of that stuff first. But I really see no need, unless you're trying to really do something, even if you're trying to do something really big, like start a corporation with funding by $100 million, I mean, there's still other ways you could do it that's more simple. It's like math. You got a multiplication problem. You got 5 different ways you could write that problem, 16 different ways you can solve by the time you get done all the different methods, and they're all right.
Mm-hmm.
You just got to know multiplication.
Okay. So let me just make sure, because I'm just a detailed person, and I will review the videos again. So on the coupon itself, I'm going to endorse in the back, and then I write the amount that I'm sending. Do I also write above the amount money order as well?
Well, you could do it as a money order. But, what he's saying is just using an endorsement. You just, you would actually, on the coupon, you would actually write your signature on front along the side somewhere and then endorse it upon the back.
Okay. Is there a need to still put the date? Like some of your videos have, where you put the date is basically equal to the year of birth.
The endorsement, if you're using the endorsement method, the only thing you need to do is just endorse it. That's it.
Okay. Do I have to write authorized representative?
Here's the thing. Let me say this. if you have an account with somebody, right?
Mm-hmm.
I'm willing to bet that they already have your pertinent information, i.e. your, or e.g. your social security number, quote-unquote address, the date they mailed you the bill, et cetera, right?
Mm-hmm.
So what they need is the approval from, let's say, the agent, the authorized agent, which is why you can simply endorse it because you're giving them the authorization to do whatever they need to do behind the scenes to get paid what you've authorized.
Okay.
That's why you ain't got to really worry about routing number, this number, that number, because it's all linked to your social to begin with anyway for entertainment purposes. So you just need to endorse it as the authorized agent, which is what the whole endorsement is, and that gives them the authority to go ahead and get paid.
So don't use the route numbers.
So basically, when you endorse it, you are the authorized agent. They already know that.
Mm-hmm. Okay. I thank you. This is much simpler than what I thought it would be.
Yeah, the problem is then they know it, but the average consumer don't know who they are.
Mm-hmm.
Remember, we were taught the debtor mind state instead of the creditor mind state. But they know who you are. Like, they, you know, the people high up top are laughing at us all, like, or, you know, like, ha ha ha, they got them, they're going to work. It's called compelled performance. And if you trace that back, it goes back to Nazi Germany for entertainment purposes.
Oh.
You know, it's the whole concept of, well, if we beat the slaves, you know, they'd be mad at us. They're not going to work real hard. But if we make them feel like they got a choice, you know, they're going to love what they do, which is why you got the whole school system and you can be anything you want to be and you go pick a major at college because you feel like you choosing what you want to be in life and they're looking at you like you're a specialized slave for entertainment purposes. And then they put the tokens in front of you, i.e. the money, the Chuck E. Cheese coins, and that's what you think you're paying. You're working hard so you can pay this bill. You're working hard so you can buy a BMW. And the whole marketing system is set up to run the commercial aspect to compel performance.
Right.
Entertainment purposes.
I have one other.
Go ahead, Susan.
Just real quick. So with all learn, you know, with due respect and learning all this fraud that's been going on and how blinded I've been, you know, I was one of these that contributed to a 401k and also investing into a life insurance policy, thinking I'm doing something great, building a cash value for my son for college purposes and, you know, death purposes and so forth. Basically, in a nutshell, and I know you're going to say, you know, for this is entertainment purposes, a person like myself, I mean, if I want to be free, I just need to stop contributing to all of these other frauds. Is that right?
Well, what is a 401k exactly?
Well, it's basically the value of an amount that's supposed to be set for retirement. But as I'm learning, there is no cash value that exists.
Let me ask you a question. How many people you know that retired off a 401k? I'm just asking.
No, not many. Just a pension.
Okay. A pension was totally different. That's, you know, that was when America still had some goodness in America, you know what I mean? Like, a pension was a real thing. Companies, you know, they stood behind that. Now, a 401k, it's a commodity. Now, here's the thing. I know, you know, we go write an equation or whatever, right? We can, you know, control the market if we are in the right place. So we tell everybody in America, 401k is the new thing, right? And then, you know, we set the stage, so to speak, with, you know, whatever it might be this year, a war, a terror attack, whatever. Because we know with that, and we raise the price of this, and we do this to the gasoline prices, the stock prices are going to plummet. Okay?
Mm-hmm.
And everybody's 401k is based on stocks. So I don't know anybody that retired off of 401k. I personally, right before the last incident, I pulled all my money out of 401k because, you know, I was learning stuff, and I realized that's not enough security for me to be, you know, trying to put away a nest egg, because the reality is when you're sovereign, you're responsible for your own, you know, you're responsible for yourself, you know? You're running your own nation. So what is a 401k really? You're giving somebody else your money. They're taking it and investing it, making more money off of it. If you want to get a couple thousand or 20,000, I mean, there was a time where, you know, I pulled 20,000 out, 401k, go buy a car. But then you got to pay it back. You paying a loan and interest on your own money. Like, you sit down and you think about, wait a minute, it's my money. It's supposed to be my money, right?
Mm-hmm.
When you go to the bank and say, okay, I want to deposit, they don't say, okay, well, you want to you want to withdraw $500, so you're going to owe us $49 to do that withdrawal, so we're going to give you $461. They don't do that, or $451. You know, they don't say that to you. But that's, in theory, what you're doing with your 401k.
So if a person has a balance, you know, not even just 401k, let's just say even like an IRA, another type of mutual fund, what do they do now with it? Just leave it? I mean, advise me on that.
I mean, you know, you know what you want to do with your money. But what you got to realize is everything you've been throwing around to all the different commercial outfits, retail centers, even in putting in your 401k, that's not real to begin with.
Right.
Okay? It's all finite, you know, I mean, excuse me, fiat currency. So what you want is to become the creditor. And then if you can fill up an account of whatever company that you need to do whatever with a credit, I mean, what do you need a pension for even?
Okay. Thank you. Thank you.
Shalom.
Shalom.
Hey, I'm still lost now, man. She got it all.
More question before you guys close it up.
Go ahead. Ask your question, buddy.
It's been my understanding that when I pay cash for my vehicle, I'm entitled, well, I know what I know now, I know to ask for the MSO. And because I have the MSO, there's no need for me to get insurance or register my vehicle because it's...
Hello.
Shalom.
Yeah.
Shalom. Oh, yeah, could you speak up a little bit?
Oh, sorry. I said that if it's to my understanding that when I pay cash for my car, I can ask for the MSO. And when I get the MSO, there's no need for me to get it.
Let me ask you a question. When you're saying you're paying cash for your vehicle, are you referring to a brand new vehicle, never been titled?
Yes.
Okay. Like 0 miles on it type?
Sir?
Are you talking about like a vehicle with 0 miles on it?
Yes, and I'm the first owner of it.
Then, yeah, you could have got the MSO prior to titling. However, once it's been titled or registered anywhere, the MSO, I'm not saying you can't get it, but the MSO go to the DMV with that, and that's why they give you the registration of title. And then what they do now, and I actually just spoke to the lady about this up in, I believe it was Massachusetts. What they do now is the DMV will destroy the title, but they keep it on, I mean, destroy the MSO, but they keep it on like a microfiche or microfilm or some sort of, you know, electronic or digital imprint of the original. So once it's been titled, they kind of like want to get rid of the MSO to kind of keep us from, you know, keep this quiet, so to speak. So it's really the best opportunity, not to say you can't get it otherwise, but the best opportunity to do that is if you're buying a brand new vehicle. Because the MSO is created to get it to wherever it's going from the manufacturer.
Right, and whoever possesses them, and so they have the say-so over, like, what has to be done to the vehicle as far as registering and insurance, things of that nature.
Well, if you have the MSO, brother, the manufacturer, you understand what the MSO truly is? It's just like the baby having a live record of birth. Anything that comes off the assembly line, they create what is known as the manufacturer statement of origin. That's the MSO. Now, that's the only real true title to anything. Like Brother Baran was just saying, when they give you a certificate of title at the DMV, it's just a certificate. You don't have the true title. The true title they have. And, yeah, if you can get the MSO, you don't have to register your vehicle. You own it. You own it. I mean, if you had the MSO, I mean, you would be a little zany to go and give it to the DMV because, yeah, you don't have to register. You may have people pulling you over, but once they pull you over and you tell them, hey, this is my vehicle, I own it, there is no trust. There is no trust set up. The problem with registering your vehicle and having that certificate of title, you create a trust. And even though you have maybe 95% of that trust, you give 5% of that trust to the DMV, and that percentage of that trust is the legal percentage. So you could drive in, you could do whatever you want to do in it, but they have the legal half, and they tell you what needs to be done. Make sure that all the lights are functioning. Make sure that you have insurance on it. But if you have the MSO, they can't tell you that because there is no trust. The trust is actually between you, the DMV, and your store man that you actually thanks you. You don't really own the vehicle. The store man owns the vehicle. You can't own the vehicle. If you know who you are, you can't own the vehicle. Like, you can't own a car. The store man can, but you can't because you're not the flesh. You're not the corporate fiction. You're not the temple. You're the spirit, so you can't own a vehicle.
And
we are the children.
Does anyone else have a question?
Yeah, I was just gonna add. Just keep in mind when you start thinking not as the debtor, but as a secure party creditor, or the creditor for short. You have unlimited liability. You know what I mean? So what? So if you could go bond a court case that's got a value of a couple mil on it, why do you feel like you can't insure your own vehicle out of the same process? I mean, you're the creditor. You can credit with your approval. You can basically credit anything because the money ain't real. It's monopoly, entertainment purposes. So, you know, like anybody listening to Biggie Small or whatever, you know, car do 160, wreck it, buy a new one. Crew run. You know what I mean? You unlimited liability partner. You know what I'm saying? You just write that stuff off, man.
What's going on, brothers? This is Jay Shine. So how's it going, brother? How's everything in Michigan, right? You in Michigan? Yeah.
Shalom, Michigan.
Yeah.
My sister has a question in regards to she just lost her job, right? And they did not give her a proper disclosure as to how she lost it. They just called her and told her she was fired. And she's gonna file her affidavit of truth claim of fact into the courts as of tomorrow. So I would like to know is where could she possibly go to notarize it? Because I don't think she has a bank. So how do we go about doing that?
Mail UPS store. I mean, you know, post anybody that's got post office boxes normally has a notary.
Okay.
Yeah, but you know, whenever you sign up for a job, there is a contract involved.
Yeah, so I have a contract.
Right, I know. any kind of person that worked on any kind of job, everything's contract. Everything's contract. You got to think of that in that sense. Now, what you have to do is actually look over the original contract, because a lot of these companies are no fault state.
But here's what you really want. Here's what I want to ask you. Did she fill out an application for the job?
Yep, I filled it out online.
Okay. Did you make any amendment or leave any certain areas? Did you not fill out part of the contract, or did you just fill it out as normal, submitted, they called you, you got hired, you started working?
Yeah.
Normally, on the application, see, an application is a setup. Now, I'm not saying you can't have a job, but I tell you what you need to do. You know what I mean? When you're presented an application, you can, or any contract for that matter, you can make amendments to it before signing it. Like I get people look at me funny all the time. You know what I'm saying? I'm fill out an application or something, because I'm in there, I'm crossing out the word application at the top, I'm putting in contract, you know, I'm crossing this out on it, you know, I'm not checking any boxes in, you know, what are you, black, this, white, you know, Hispanic, and black, you know, I'm writing in something in that area. I'm not checking no boxes, you know, so once you do certain things, you continue the power of attorney process. And that's what the HR department is. They kind of do all that back end power of attorney stuff, behind the scenes stuff. So.
And it's like I got a union in my job, and the union, we do have a contract, and the grounds that I was fired on was basically because I worked the 8-hour shift last night. I worked third shift, and I work at a nurse home, and it's something that's called mandation. Mandation is like you have to stay for a mandatory 4 hours after work. And a guy called in for work, and they're supposed to go by guidelines. A lot of things are done by seniority. And she didn't go down the seniority list to call to see if she can filled the position, which is stated in the contract. I was just mandated.
This contract that you're referring to, is this the contract you have with the union, or the contract that the union has with who was your employer at the time?
Well, basically, the contract is with the union, but we're the union because that's what they just, after 90 days, after your 90 days, you're just automatically a part of the union. And I don't know if it's something that, you know, goes along, like I say, with the application.
Application, right? You know, that's one downfall. You know, and do you know the origin of the unions in America?
No, I don't. You know, I just really started looking into this. I'm only 22.
Okay, no, there's no such thing as time. You know, so what I'm gonna say is, I don't personally like unions, because that's like having an attorney. For entertainment purposes.
Mm-hmm.
You got somebody else representing you and how you going to get paid instead of you being able to talk to the people that's paying you. Which, you know, I'm going to paraphrase this, but anything that's done behind closed, any meeting that's done behind closed doors, shielded from the public and secret, ain't good for the people. And you ain't in those union contract meetings. That's just how I'm going to address that. Now, whether you got a valid case or whatnot, you know, that, you know, we have to scour through the contract, see exactly what you're talking about, see what exactly happened. It's a lot of details. I mean, you can look for that email that Brother Todd posts. We can maybe look into that for you. But I'm going to tell you, I don't like unions, especially if you know the origin of how the unions got started in America. Because they ain't.
And, you know, I mean, of course, you know, the way I'm looking at it right now is I don't even know if I really wanted to fight it. I just wanted to hear your advice on it. I mean, my intentions was to try to, you know, fight it, but I don't know if I'm just going to go ahead and go to school and just let it go.
A school is another, you know, degree is another contract. You know what I mean? So, like, you got to understand.
Yeah. Well, I was going to school for cosmetology.
Yeah, yeah. Remember, whatever you go to school for, it's a contract, it's a degree. Because the reality is, as a creditor, you have unlimited liability. As a sovereign, you don't need to have a license to cut your neighbor's hair. Because guess what? I'm from the hood. And if somebody down the street could braid hair, when I was getting braids, you know, before I got my dreads, she was braiding my hair. I didn't, cosmetology license, nah, I seen the last hair she did, that was tight, that's what's up.
Right.
License and a permit, anything you need a license or a permit for is simply a revenue stream for somebody else to make money off of what you want to do in life.
Right.
So I'm not saying you can't utilize a class here, a class there if you want to get skills up or whatever, whatever.
Right.
Saying a degree is a contract. An application
I don't think you can get a degree in,
About the certificate, the certificate is the same thing as, like, a degree because you had to apply for it, you gave this amount of your energy, and then they just making money off.
You gotta look up what it takes to be a government employee, and because I encourage you to hear a tidbit. That's why I don't give you the whole answer. You know, I might give you 99, 98, 90% because I encourage you to go and look this up yourself because I'm not gonna be there next week. I mean, unless you got plane tickets for me and Taz to come out there and, you know, help you out. I might not be there. So I need you to know this stuff for yourself wholeheartedly, you know.
Right.
When you look up what it takes to be a government employee, you'll see that you got to either go through extensive training or be, appointed, Taz? Or be appointed by, like, an official or something, which is why, i.e., again, remember I said they're giving you the choice now what's servitude you want to be in as a slave, you know. But, yeah, going through that system is basically just saying I've been trained as this.
Right.
I'm contracted to do this work for the government, and I'm going to try to find a work or employment, which is a whole other – just look that definition up in my field of specialties. That I have a degree contract with the government.
Okay.
So, I mean, there's no book they're going to give you in a college degree that you can't buy yourself and read on your own accord.
True.
But because Professor says that you took his class and he has a contract with the government, now you are accredited as a knowledgeable person per their system. And then the problem with that is they don't even teach you all the truth, so to speak, for entertainment purposes. They just teach you what they want you to know to continue the system.
And right, and you know what? And it's just like...
And you said, hold on, real quick. You said cosmetology, right?
Mm-hmm.
See, anything that ends in ology is kind of like, biology, cosmetology, archaeology.
Right.
That's a cover-up for the truth. You know what I mean? That's why they got this thing called Egyptology. Because now they can screen all the information that's being released by the archaeologists under Egyptology. You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
And tell you, oh, this is how you straighten black people's hair, and this is how you do this, because it's cosmetology. Our hair shouldn't be straightened, you know what I mean? Your spiral is part of your superconductivity. You're a transducer. So they want you to lose your power and look like the Europeans, so they flood that information in through cosmetology.
Okay.
That's how they control the knowledge. I don't like anything that ends in knowledge. That's just, you know, for entertainment purposes, that's my opinion.
Okay. And, you know, it's just like I've been so naive to it. But I'm trying to get it together. It's just so hard once you've been doing something for so long, you know.
You know, they teach you the pyramids or tombs. Ain't nobody ever found no body. There's evidence that it was producing electricity and electromagnetic fields thousands of years before they say that technology ever existed. When you do the research, but that's why they call it research, because they're taking our knowledge and they're researching how you do this, and they're telling you what they want you to know.
Right.
You just got no terms.
And, I mean, that's, yep.
Everybody get a black slot.
All right, thank y'all, brothers, for laying that piece of informational and educational information on my sister.
Shalom.
Shalom.
Thank you.
Is there anyone else with a question? Hit and large question? What about Jackie Williams? Do you have a question?
I had one more.
Hey, brother.
About the, you said you can, you have the right to change anything on a contract. I can't remember what you write. What do you write before you sign your name?
On what?
On a contract. Like, everything is non-disclosed before you sign it, so. What do you write before you sign your name?
I mean, you don't have to write. You don't have to write anything. I mean, if you've altered the contract.
Oh, I think I know what he's saying. Like, you know, maybe after your name, you're saying how do you really sign and not be liable or be able to like dispute the contract later or say that I didn't agree with this? Is that what you're saying?
Yeah, like if I change something in the contract before I sign it, I'd just sign my name.
No, no, you have a right. A contract is an agreement between two or more parties. If there's not agreement between both parties, then there's no contract. There has to be agreement. I'm not sure if you was listening like last week when I went over, maybe it was the week before that when we actually went over contract law. There has to be an agreement. So, I mean, if you don't agree with something, say if someone's trying to say, well, this is going to cost you $1,000 in the contract. You have a right to draw a line through that and put $500, as Brother Bowen was saying. So, I mean, there has to be an agreement first before the contract takes place. Now, the way that they get around that is there's things known as adhesion contracts that most companies use, which actually has a hidden, you know, they're hiding their actual intent. It's actually an adhesion contract. They put it in extremely small letters so you can't read the small print, and most people are not going to try and read that anyways. Or they'll draft up some long, you know, policy or whatever, and most people don't take the time to read that. And they print it so small because it's not intended for you to read it. You need a magnifying glass to read it. Those are adhesion contracts. And you have unilateral contracts, which is actually one-sided, which is what most companies actually use. Most corporations are going to use a unilateral contract that's actually in their favor. And some of them will tell you, well, if you don't agree with this, you can't work here. But you still have a right to, like, draw through that contract. But me, when I sign anything, I mean, sometimes people get a little irritated, but, hey, I don't care. That's an emotion. Emotions come and they go. Like, when I sign something, I always sign without prejudice. All rights reserved, UCC 1-308. I always sign that. Any kind of contract, unless it's an affidavit. I don't put that on an affidavit because I don't want to invalidate my affidavit.
Yeah, UCC-108.
You
want to do without prejudice, all rights reserved, UCC 1-308. Now, if you're not familiar with that, you probably should get familiar with that.
I was just kind of like, I didn't feel like going back in my notes and exactly what it is right now, and you could tell me.
And to add to that, on a simple contract, if you've gone through and changed everything to something that you want, then if you totally have read the contract thoroughly and you've made any changes, then you've already protected yourself, I mean, to a degree, right?
Right. Okay, I would just make sure of that because I don't really sign since I've thought about it and always sign all rights reserved, but I didn't put without prejudice or in UCC on there. But I don't really like signing things anymore.
Yeah, and just like he said about the small print on your check, in your checkbook. if you pull a magnifying glass out on that, normally it's going to say something like authorized agent, authorized user, something like that. That's not actually a solid line there. That's actually microprint.
Right, right, right.
So, I mean, it's everywhere for entertainment purposes.
Okay. They got something else, like, sometimes they got a little lock on there, too, like the checks. The check looks like a little tiny lock on there. They must have something about the booth.
Well, I got another question.
Oh, yeah, you can go ahead, Nick. Help me out, but you can go ahead with your questions.
Okay, I told you that, like, I'm really not familiar with being sovereign. So I was wondering, like, where would I go start, you know what I'm saying, to look for information?
Isn't Deshaun your brother?
Yeah, Deshaun my brother, but I got my own place. Like, it's just, like, I used to work so much, I didn't have time just to sit down and really get into it. Yeah, that's my brother, and he, you know, we're going to get it together.
Well, he's pretty knowledgeable. you have a knowledge base in your next of kin, and you could actually tune into these radio shows and watch some videos on YouTube and just read. Get yourself a Black Law's Dictionary, read some UCC. But to become a sovereign, well, you're actually already a sovereign. You just actually need to know who you are, where you live, know your country. Those are the three basic principles of sovereignty. You need to know who you are. If you think that you're, what's your name?
Sierra.
Yeah, if you think that you're Sierra, then yeah, you're definitely not a sovereign. You're actually just a corporation. You're corporate fiction. You're a slave. You're akin to the straw woman, a straw man, because
right.
You don't know who you are. And that's why many of us get in trouble. They send us a charge, and we think that we got to go to court. But they're not calling us to court. They're calling the straw man to court, and we go there and we stand in place of the straw man and acknowledge ourselves as the straw man.
Okay, yeah. Now, you know, I done seen you on YouTube a couple of times. And, okay, I got another situation. My boyfriend, he was driving or whatever, and he got pulled over traveling. He got pulled over, and he got arrested and went to jail, and the car got towed. And so when I called the tow company, they told me that I needed to go to the police station and get a, what do you call it, I guess it's a towing, some type of towing paper to in order for me to get my property from the tow company.
What? So was it your vehicle or his vehicle?
It's my vehicle.
So what is the tow company saying, that there's a specific amount of money that was owed?
No, I'm guessing they are going to pay me, I mean, charge me for towing it and for storage. But they told me I didn't get something.
Why would you pay that? Did you contract with them? Did you agree with that?
No.
Did you? Yeah. So I mean, why would you pay that? The policeman gave the order to tow the vehicle, right?
Yeah.
So the tow company actually towed the vehicle without your consent.
Well, to add real quick, the only reason that they can do that as far as towing the vehicle or put a boot on it for that matter, remember that when you registered the vehicle, you basically gave them the car. They're the real title holders of the vehicle behind the scenes, because there's a whole separate title that's on the market as a commodity and just like the home. So the only reason they can tow the car or put a boot on your vehicle and it not be vandalism is because they're the owners by law.
And I heard you tell somebody that. I heard you just tell somebody that just a little while ago.
Yeah, well, I mean, yeah, what Moran is saying is true. But this is where I start to offer my conditional acceptance. The moment that this policeman decides that he's going to tow my vehicle, the first thing that I'm going to tell him, I could conditionally accept your offer. upon proof of claim, you know, you have a right to seize my property and the tow company. I will hold them liable as well. I would also conditionally accept him trying to tow my vehicle. And pretty much, for me personally, I can't tell you what to do. I probably would end up in the commercial lien against that tow company. And as for the policeman, I don't know. I don't understand what actually happened during the course of the stop. But the vehicle wasn't even registered to whoever was driving the vehicle. Were you in the vehicle when the vehicle got towed? Were you with your boyfriend?
No.
So the policeman, what he should have done was actually gave, you know, you a call, or your boyfriend should have said, well, I want to get the owner of the vehicle a call. Don't tow the vehicle. But if they towed it, I charged them for towing my vehicle. I would charge them for all of the time that I was unable to get from work. I mean, that would turn into something major for me, because I would have been like, well, I can't get the work done, tow my vehicle, and so on and so forth. Anything that I could actually sit down and think of. And your boyfriend, what was the charge against him?
Driving on a suspended license. Well, but he never even had a driver's license. He never even got a license.
Oh, so that, I mean, that's even better. So how's he driving on a suspended license if he never had one?
Right, but he don't understand that, because he believe in, I guess, not being free, not being, knowing himself. He believe in the straw man. He believe in Alvin.
Oh, yeah. I mean, but if he never had, so they charge him with driving on a suspended license or driving without a license, because he doesn't even fall under that jurisdiction if he doesn't have a driver's license. He doesn't even fall under that jurisdiction. So, I mean, the policeman can't, if he had no license, how did the policeman even get identification from him? How did they so-called ID him?
Well, actually, he's a parolee, so he just kind of, I guess, consent, yeah.
So the police said, oh, we're going to place you under arrest, and he just agreed and went along and said, okay. And the police just said, okay, put your hands behind your back, and he did it.
I wasn't there, but I believe that's the way it happened.
Yeah, that's definitely consenting. That's definitely a debtor. That's definitely a debtor. If they tell you to do something without even putting their hand on your body, then you're definitely consenting. Now, if they tell you to do something, you say, I conditionally accept your offer, and they actually put their hands on you, then that's not consent. That's, in my case, that's going to be kidnapped. That's, in my case, from that point, from the point of the traffic stop, when they pull me over, I'm operating under protest and duress. Because right now, one of the questions that I asked them is, can I leave? They tell me I can't leave, then that's a short arrest, whether they let me go or not. That's a short arrest, because they're holding me under their custody. I don't even care if it was for 2 minutes. I couldn't leave. If they tell me that I can leave, then hey, yeah, that's okay. But if I can't leave, then they need to anticipate receiving something back from me for kidnap, because that's kidnap. I don't care if they kidnap me for 2 minutes. If I can't leave, and these policemen have me under duress, then you need to learn to start what is known as a control fee. And for every moment, a minute, that they have you, then you charge them a control fee for your time, for the time that they held you unwillingly without your consent. I don't consent to anything. That's one of the first things that I tell them. And I think I get pulled over more than any person in America. I just really believe that. I get pulled over probably 5 times out of 10 times that I go out. Maybe the percentage is higher. I'm not exaggerating that. I get pulled over so much. But they never write me tickets. Never. Never write me tickets. They always, oh, well, we're just going to give you a warning.
Why?
Maybe it's my prevention. I weed my stuff. I don't act like a debtor. Like, oh, well, they start acting like a creditor. I don't act like a debtor.
Right.
I don't start arguing. And I don't ask questions that actually lead them into being able to entrap me. I don't ask questions that I don't know the answer to. You never ask questions that you don't already know the answer to. Never. And you answer all of those questions, their questions, with a question. You never make any statements because we can't prove anything. So if they ask me a question, may I see your driver's license, registration, insurance? Well, I sit on, may I see your business card?
Right.
And make sure he has a badge doing, and your identification. Because without that, hey, to me, he's not in uniform. And to me, all that is a costume. And I told him he shouldn't have pulled me over because I didn't like his costume in the beginning. So if he can't produce those, then I don't have to produce mine. And when I do produce mine, I could just put them up against the window. I roll my window partially down about 2 inches or an inch, just enough, with my doors locked to get the ID through, put the ID against it. And if he wants to give me his, then I'll give him mine. You don't have to give them to him. Where's the law, a statute that says that you have to hand them to him? When you hand them to him, you're placing yourself under his authority. He just used that as a form of authority. Let me tell you something. Every time that a policeman pulls you over, I know because I used to be one. I was in military police for a while. Every time a policeman pulls you over, they run your plate. The computer in the vehicle taps into the DMV. They already know if you have insurance. They already know if your registration is suspended. They know that before they come to your vehicle. But they come and ask for it. They want you to consent to something. Now, I'm not saying that you give them an argument, but I'm saying that you need to behave like a creditor. You answer their questions with questions.
Asking.
Right. Because when you're asking, you're as king. The person that's asking the questions are in charge. You're as king.
Like you said, they already have information in their systems, which is why really people sometimes ask me, well, what's the benefit of filing paperwork and these documents you say you got on file? You know what I mean? Because when they run it through their systems, before they give you the copies back or before they send you back your original documents, they make copies of it all. So when they pull you over, that car is in your name. If your documents are, if you've already put this on public record who you really are, then a control fee, it's also known as a fee schedule. All that is part of your documentation. So anything besides, oh, have a good day, is him, you know, just being a fool or her, the officer, being a fool for entertainment purposes only, because you already got this all documented about who you are and what the fee is if, like you say, you short of rest. And then they want to talk, you know, he might ask you for your ID and stuff, and you're like, no, you know, here, show you whatever. Then he's going to throw his hand on his gun. Well, that's a threat. You know what I mean? Now you're under duress giving them your information because you don't want to get shot. You know what I'm saying? So once you got your fee schedule on, you just go back. Okay, he finally let you go. Now you go home, and you start going through your fee schedule. Okay, yeah, that's the definition of this is, I felt threatened. I was restrained. Not detained necessarily, but restrained. It was a short arrest. Yep. Mm-hmm. This and all my stuff is like $2 million per incident, per officer, agent involved. You know, so they're gonna either let that ticket go, or you're gonna have a pretty hefty whatever as your counterclaim.
Okay. So, with your custom plates, because I know each of you have one on your vehicle, I have not to hire my custom plate.
No, I don't have a custom plate. I have a regular plate. So I have a driver. I don't have a driver's license, custom plate, anything like that. Tyler Doc has a driver's license. Tyler Doc has a vehicle registration. I don't have any of that. But I use it when I actually want to use it to my advantage, but I have a driver's license in case I want to operate in commerce. So I use it when I need to use it. Otherwise, I don't use it.
Yeah.
So what do you consider an act of commerce? Because are you a cabbie or any form of
Exactly. I mentioned this on a previous show or call. You don't need a driver's license to you're not driving,
Right.
You're traveling.
Right.
So when you look up the driver, it's pizza delivery driver. It's a UPS driver.
Right.
Driver. That's your operating a vehicle and you're making money in a sense. Now, when you look at, somebody mentioned insurance. When you look at your insurance policy, they talk about passengers. Well, your contrivance is really what your vehicle is, and that's your rite of passage. And you don't have passengers. You have visitors or guests in your space that you own. So now if somebody says, I'll give you, you know, $50, take me across town, now they're a passenger, yeah.
Yeah.
But if they're just making a donation to, you know, the gas tank or something, you know, that's different. You know what I'm saying? Because if I come over your crib and give you $50 to order the fight, you see what I'm saying?
You're a movie theater.
You're a movie theater. But if I come in and say, hey, yeah, you know, this is, you know, whatever, me and you, we buddies, buddy, ha-ha, I'll help you out with, you know what I mean? Now I'll make it a donation. That's something different. So you need your driver's license to operate in commerce because that's the equivalent of the state ID that you're going to need to fill out or show or present any, you know, financial, anything financial pretty much. You're operating in commerce with your driver's license.
Right.
But they taught you in school you need that to drive.
Right.
You do, but you're not a driver. That's the whole trickery going on for entertainment purposes.
You never heard that. You never heard that. What do you think they call limousine drivers? Drivers. They call them that all day, and you hear. But in place though, just to show that you're not acting under commerce, then I put not for hire on mine.
On your what?
On my license plate, just for identification for my property.
Well, do you have an MSO to that vehicle?
No, I haven't.
Well, you're not authorized to put custom plates on the DMV's vehicle that you actually voluntarily gave over to them when you registered the vehicle. Again, you may own 95% of that vehicle. They own the 5%, which is the most essential part, which is the legal half. So they have legal authority over that vehicle. And if you get pulled over with those custom plates by one of their constables on patrol, then you're going to be susceptible to the penalties because you voluntarily gave them authority over that vehicle when you created the trust by way of registration.
Now, hold on. Are you saying plates that you actually made yourself or plate through the DMV?
That we made.
Yeah, then what he's saying is applicable.
What he's actually doing is what I've seen a lot of the Moorish brothers doing. They go out and they create their own personal plates. But those that do that don't really understand a trust. You know, whenever you register your vehicle, you create a trust with the state. And although that you own the vast majority of that trust, and the trust is actually created, and I said this in one of my videos, between you, your straw man, and the DMV. Now, when you sign for your driver's license, you contract to agree to everything within that Driver Motor Vehicle Act, which is approximately 200 or some pages that none of us actually read. So you agree to everything in that Driver Motor Vehicle Act. So when you go out and you run a stop sign, you haven't broken any type of law, but you offended one of their codes that you agree to uphold. So now you'll have to go back and forth and trying to dispute this and get out of that. But in real truth, you agreed to this. You consented to it by signing off on the Driver Motor Vehicle Act by way of the driver's license. So when you go out and you put private plates on the driver motor vehicle's car, you can't do that because it's not your car to do. Well, it's partially your car, mostly your car, but you don't have the legal ownership over that property. So it's thereby their property because the legal half is the most important half. So they can tell you what to do. They can tell you, well, if you don't have insurance, we're going to write you a ticket and you're going to pay over $1,000 fine. And we might just throw you in jail for a few days to make some more money off you that way.
Yeah, it's actually what they've done is like when he was talking about titles, you don't have the real title to the vehicle. So the real title to the vehicle has probably been around the world and it's got a bunch of stamps on the back of it. Kind of like a passport.
Right, exactly.
Because it's been commoditized.
Just like the original birth certificate. That's exactly what happens to your original birth certificate. It goes all the way around the world because it'd be in the stock markets just like a stock.
Exactly. So the reason why they want to inspect it is just like if you wanted to keep the value of a property that you were looking to possibly sell later on, you got all these things. You're going to clean your gun. You're going to make sure the holster don't scratch it. You ain't going to drop it all over the place, get banged up, because you want it to be in good condition, you know? Now, what you have as it being registered is you have the relative privilege to drive the vehicle. You got to remember that.
Right.
But that's why you got the tags on there and the registration and stuff.
Okay. So, in addition, you having holding the MSO, and then you still registering your vehicle as what? You register your vehicle as a trust to them because it's a contract. Is that what you're saying?
That puts it in their hands. Once you do it, they own it.
When I went over the 10 rules of commerce, was you actually listening to the core? Anything, you give up title. In other words, let's exchange that word title to ownership. You give up ownership. You don't own it anymore, and the only true title is the MSO. If you don't have that, you don't have the true title. You have a certificate of title. Maybe you should go to Blackmore's Dictionary and define certificate and see what it really means. You have a certificate of title. That's not true ownership.
And if you look at the title you got for that car, it definitely says certificate of title, you know? It doesn't say title on it, which totally changed the meaning of that document.
Okay.
Right. Making payments on it still, like if it's owned by a finance company, then that's a quick can of worms.
But you can't
get
stuff about it just about all of that, correct?
Excuse me?
You can accept for value just about all of them.
Yeah, I mean, pretty much anything that's got.
Yeah, brother, if you accept, you got to understand what accept for value is when you're actually doing it. When you accept something for value, remember that account is settled and closed. If you accept your driver's license or something for value like that with the DMV, what you're going to do is close that account. So, when you accept it for value, you're going to close the account on your driver's license. Then you're going to get pulled over for driver's license because they closed that account. Because
the
account
driver's license
is closed.
No, I was talking about as far as the mortgage goes on the vehicle. Say, for instance, I wanted to go in and buy a new car. I could accept that.
You can't make a purchase with it. Remember, it's got to be a debt. But you can't show up and say, okay, print me out something that says this is the value of the car, this is the VIN number, and let me just accept it for value right here in front of you. Can't do that. Because then you're trying to make a purchase. You got to look that word up. You can't make a purchase. You got to thing off the debt. So you got to actually have the financing go through and actually have the debt and an account, et cetera, that you can then discharge the account itself, and that would pay off the vehicle.
So, and of course, do you have to have a FICO score in order for that to occur?
I don't know why you would. What do you mean a FICO score?
That would be like
to get the initial financing. That could be the case. But you may not be able to go out and buy, you know, an $84,000 BMW straight from the lot, get it financed, and then go write it off. I'm not saying you can or can't, but depending on your credit score, yeah, you might not be able to do that. But you might wind up with a Nissan Altima and then go write that off. But, I mean, once you get do that, you can sell your Nissan Altima, put that down on the $82,000 BMW, and then do it again.
So, far as if this is, I have a place of employment. I go in as an independent contractor. Won't I be, like, I will be exempt from all type of claims? Like, say, for instance, they give me my W-2 forms, them W-2 forms, and I sign those, but I accept it for value, and then I change the conditions or... And then I give it back to him.
Well, I mean, when you say accept it for value, you're talking about like...
I accept it. I take it. I change the conditions or I amend them, in a sense. I amend them to my whim. And then I endorse it. My autograph in the bottom where it says my name here or whichever or signature. And then it goes into the Internal Revenue Service. But there's no birth certificate. Or, I mean, not birth certificate, but a Social Security number on it because I never put my Social Security card number on anything.
The way to truly access your trust account is by way of that social insurance number. That's the true way to access your account. And remember this also. The front is always public. The back is always private. The number on the front of that Social Security card is not your number. It's the number that's on back in red that's yours. The front's always public. The back's always private.
What about the older ones? Because my aunt has an extremely old birth certificate, and it doesn't have any red numbers on the back.
You're saying you're talking birth certificate or Social Security?
Oh, Social Security. I'm sorry. I yelled.
Then she can send over for another one. You're entitled to up to 5 within a lifetime.
Oh. I expressed that to her, but she... didn't understand.
So, Brother Moran, I guess we could bring this to a close. We actually went way over. Last night was a catastrophe, but tonight we actually put in like 3 hours. So, we actually thank everyone for calling in. We're going to actually bring this to a close. Generally, we are actually here on Tuesdays. We're only here tonight because last night there was some technical difficulties, but we actually thank everybody for tuning in and hope you have a blessed evening.
Thank you.
Thank you.
All right, everybody.